Okay, well, I'm gonna say right out of the gate, you all know what it's like. I'm a lawyer, so really remarkable person. And what he said to me was, Jim, please make it brief. And he reminded me of 5 B's of public speaking. Be brief, brother, be brief. Well, R.T. Rybak is a remarkable person. He is a real legend, really, in Minneapolis and St. Paul. I got to know a few years ago, we both were at the, what's called the Mayor's Institute for City Design. It was held in Charleston by the mayor of Charleston for 34 years, Joe Rybak. And I knew then when I met R.T. for the first time that this was a guy who was described this morning by the president of the university as an inspirational leader. That's exactly what he is. He was mayor for a dozen years, from 2002 to 2014 in Minneapolis. He was described often as Mr. Enthusiasm, a carnival barker for his city, a wonderful cheerleader for his city. And I think the best description of what you're going to get with this speaker came from Linda Grassi. Linda, who organizes this thing, and so much of it, like the rest of the team from Commerce Lexington, Linda said that when they did the planning trip, when they came here, and they went around the city asking folks who would be good to speak about regionalism. And the answer was, R.T. Rybak. Who would be good to talk about and speak to us about the economy? R.T. Rybak. Who would be good to talk with us about diversity and education and city development? And the answer is always R.T. Rybak. So let me give you all R.T. Rybak. But before I do that, before I present him as your speaker, R.T., I'm going to present to you the key to the city of Lexington. All right? Now, y'all, there's not many of these, and there's just a few of them. It's got the blue horse on it. And as you come up here, I'm going to tell you real quickly, R.T., that this symbol of our city represents the sign in Lexington from the 1850s. And I don't think that you've got the money from our city. And what it will do for you, there you go. I am told, I don't know whether it's false or apocryphal or not, but I am told that if you give it to any tavern proprietor in Lexington, we will get you in with a free libation. All right. You all give us let's give a warm welcome to Mayor R.T. Rybak.
Well, thanks so much, Mayor. I really, really appreciate that. I'm going to come down here, too. I have to, first off, say I met the mayor in Charleston, and we were there also with Mayor Fisher of Louisville, and it was so incredibly impressive how much they were working together. And so the regional lecture should come from you guys here. So thanks, Mayor. I really appreciate that. I'm moving around a little strangely today. I have the most Minnesotan of injuries. You know, we're a place that's super active, and we were named the number one bike city in America, the most active city, and all of these other things. But we also happen to have a chain of lakes throughout the center of the city. So after work a couple days ago, I had to blow up paddleboard in the back of my car, and I went out paddleboarding for about 4 hours, and I threw my back out. So if I look like I'm moving a little stiff, that's my problem. But that is what it's like to live here. It's a place where we're active 4 seasons long. And I really encourage you to come here in February, okay? Unless that settles down. You can see it during the Super Bowl this year, which we're hosting, but it's true all the time. One of our most exciting new festivals is called the Great Northern, which we have the first weekend in February. Huge tourism season here, but we try to push it off. But what we do then is that we really celebrate winter. We have the only urban cross-country ski race, that race every year. We have a big ski jump that people ice skate down. It's up on the hill here by the cathedral. We have ice globes on the lakes and dog sled races and all that. So come visit us 4 seasons. We love having it. I want to give you just a little bit of an overview of this place. You've obviously been around a bit at some time, so let me just sort of put you in a little bit of a context. This is a a beautiful city. When I say city, Minneapolis-St. Paul is one city. You have to pay our property taxes to different people, but it is one city. We get an argument about that from lots of people, but I don't really draw any lines between these. But it's a beautiful place, but it's really where the west, or where the east meets the west. What it really meant pre-settlement is it's a very important place in the topography of this country, because you would have started on the East Coast and walked for days and days and days through the big woods, which must have been spectacular, but you could barely see in front of your eyes. You would walk and walk and walk until you came here to the only waterfall in Mississippi, right where the woods meet the prairies. So you can imagine after all of those days of walking, as the woods gave way to the prairie, the skies would open up, and we like to think this is where vision begins. But it's really where the west meets, where the east meets the west. St. Paul is often seen as a more eastern city, more originally with a deep industrial base, with a lot of reason. Minneapolis is more, I would say, forward-looking. St. Paul's done a much better job of maintaining some of these spectacular buildings that you're often being torn down in Minneapolis, probably the Russian things about tomorrow there. So it's an interesting thing, but primarily it's really one city where the east meets the west. In my city of Minneapolis, the dominant feature is the natural waterfall in Mississippi, which when the beginning of the northern part of the state was being harvested from all the trees, it became a place where the grains could come down the river, became a milling center, then it became the milling capital of the world. But then, like a lot of cities much later, our city went through an industrial collapse in about the late 1800s. And what that meant is that those mills converted to industry. And so the mills became what became later General Mills and Pillsbury and food serving businesses like Cargill. And out of that, we developed an incredibly robust economy. So we went through this change to a service economy decades, almost a century before much of America did. And what that meant is this was always a place that had a disproportionate number of Fortune 500 headquarters. You heard some of them, Target, 3M, Ecolab, Best Buy, General Mills. I can go through Medtronic, I can go through laundry list, so we're very proud of that. But also what happened early on is that we developed an ethic here about the common good. So if you go to those lakes that I was talking about in Minneapolis, lots of cities have beautiful physical amenities. But Minneapolis had a park system that more than 100 years ago made sure that every bit of that was reserved for the public. So a lot of wealthy people live near the lakes, but they don't live on the lakes. The lakes are reserved for everyone. The park system, more than 100 miles throughout the city, is about saying that every single person deserves the common ground. That's true in our civic world, too. We have one of the most successful United Ways in the country, one of the most charitable communities. I lead the Minneapolis Foundation now. It's the second oldest community foundation in the country, one of the largest. And what that means is that there's a real culture of giving here. It's also meant we've had a big infrastructure to support those in need, and a special focus on making sure that it's a place that welcomes those from other parts of the world who are in trouble. We live the values of the Statue of Liberty. So we've had Center for Victims of Torture, the Advocates for Human Rights, Children's Heartland. I could go on with many, many different groups doing work, either internationally on relief or helping refugee resettlement. So, for instance, we have the largest Somali population outside of Mogadishu. St. Paul especially has been centered for Hmong immigrants who fought with us in Vietnam, and then either those people or their relatives came here. Karen population from what is often called Burma are here as well. So we have a very large population of people from other places. That creates much complexity. We speak 130 languages and dialects in our schools, and that creates tremendous challenges. But if you put all of that together with those Fortune 500 headquarters and with the other parts of what we like to call an inclusive place, what that means is we are growing a workforce that is able to compete far better than almost any other city in a global economy. So, for instance, the thing I was most proud of as mayor was I started a summer job program called Step Up. And we put 24,000 kids into high quality summer jobs, not just equipment or anything. They worked at all the major companies. They were 80% kids of color, 50+% from immigrant families, and 24,000 of them have gone through that program. We have many other programs like that too. The biggest mistake we made is we never did an alumni association, which from my school, and I'll talk to you a little bit about workforce, we really are upset with ourselves for not doing it. But now at the Minneapolis Foundation with Greater MSP and Fantastic Group, we're starting something called Connects. It's a database and social network for graduates of the Step Up program. That's 24,000. Project Success, that's 100,000. College Possible, I think that's about 30,000. All of them are going into a common database. And then that will be, we'll have a board of HR directors of all the big companies. So we have to harvest from this globally fluent group. And what's really interesting about it is when you think about it, my work between being mayor and now was leading an initiative on closing the achievement gap for kids of color in school. And it is absolutely true that there are huge challenges, but if we can solve these gaps that we have in education, and especially disproportionately along racial lines, we can have the workers we need, even in a city like this that has the lowest metropolitan unemployment rate, I think still high than any metropolitan in the country. What it does mean, however, is that we have to reframe these issues. We talk about gaps, we talk about deficits, we talk about being welcoming to people from other places who are in trouble. But we also have to recognize, and I think we have a very strong ethic about this here, that it's not as if just one part of the population needs to change. Here's what I mean by that. When I first went to China to do business, I was a little uncomfortable. It's a fascinating place. I traveled around, been also to foreign countries, but I've never for that long, I've never for that long been in a place trying to do business, trying to lead, I was leading the delegation, in a place where I was not part of the majority culture. I didn't really put that together. I wrote my wife this email saying, I think we are kind of lonely here. Well, when I put it together, I recognized that I, as at that point, a big 50-year-old white man, had really never, for an extended period, done business in a place where I was not part of the majority culture. Well, now put my experience up against an immigrant who came from a refugee camp in Kenya to living here, they cross barriers every day. Put my experience up against that of an African-American boy in North Minneapolis who goes across town to high school, downtown with a job and back home, who is constantly navigating through different places, code shifting throughout that. And you begin to get a sense of what we really look at as we look at the workforce development. We are about numbers. We are about getting more people into this fast-growing economy we have. But we will not be able to compete unless all of us get much more immersed in crossing cultures. I am a 62-year-old white man who is rapidly going to be a dinosaur unless I get a dramatic immersion in culture. I can't go to work at Target, which sells to people from every single part of this country, every single culture, without being able to get outside of my, literally, outside of my own skin. I can't go to work at Ecolab down the street, which is producing water systems around the world. You think about where water systems are being produced. You can't go into that as a person of the majority culture without some sense of cultural fluency. And so what's interesting is that when we talk about closing gaps, we are really talking about all of us closing gaps. As a member of the majority culture, have got to get acclimated to that. That's not a political statement, that's just a statement of the reality. And so what that means is that when we're creating an organization like Connect, we're very much about with that, that every person is an asset in a different way. That's not easy, that's not comfortable necessarily in the environment we're operating in, but it's absolutely essential on what we're doing today. And I want to open it up to see wherever you want to go, because there's a lot of topics I can talk to you about, but I'll illustrate it with the most fascinating piece of research I heard in all the time I was doing that work in education disparities. And after a couple hours, we're looking at what we could do collectively on math. How could we really move people forward on math standards? And very smart researchers were talking about an hour and a half in. One of the researchers said something that on the face of it is very simple. He said, my daughter was teaching English in Los Angeles, and she was just having a devil of a time teaching negative numbers. Now think about teaching kids negative numbers. Okay, here's zero, okay, that's simple. Here's two, there's zero again. How do you describe negative numbers to kids? It's a really weird abstract concept. And these kids, in her classroom in Los Angeles were not getting negative numbers at all. So not a big deal. She comes back, she moves home to Minneapolis, which everyone should. And so she moves back to Minneapolis. She's teaching now. And she's going through the same. Here's zero, here's two, here's zero. The kids got negative numbers just like this. Now, why would kids in Minnesota understand negative numbers? January, right? Okay. Which is really interesting. But when you apply it to this plan making, it's even more interesting. Stop and think about this for a second. These kids in Minnesota, because of their lived experience, develop the knowledge that we can all use, right? If those kids from Los Angeles lived here, boy, they would know negative numbers, right? But if you apply that to the thing I'm talking about why we spend so much time trying to diversify our workforce, why we're trying to move it forward, think about that kid who was born in Somalia, goes to the refugee camp in Kenya, lives in three other places, moves here. The lived experience they had, like those kids in Minnesota, gave them an asset that we can all use. If we can find a way to leverage the collective knowledge and life experiences of an increasingly diverse community and increasingly diverse country and global economy, we can be a powerhouse. And I would predict for you that when you look at the issue of what is going to happen with our country's competitiveness across the globe, let's just take the African continent for a second and look at how China is completely dominating the African continent. What is the antidote for that? I would say it's Minneapolis-St. Paul, where we have welcomed immigrants from Liberia, Somalia, Tanzania, Sierra Leone, and go on and on with that. So what I say is that if you look at these issues, look at this as a place that is part of the Great American Experiment, the one that started way, way back, and included the Statue of Liberty, but is alive and well here, and I think you will see over this next couple of decades a place that recognizes that the best way for any one of us to get ahead is together. So with that, why don't I open up whatever questions you want to go at, or if you want to go live, I'm open. How successful has Connection? Connection is just launching. It launched in the fall. So what we've done so far is we've gone to these high-performing out-of-school initiatives. We said, look, we're going to give you a free database. It's all your own, but the back end is going to connect to this overall. They like that. They're a little tentative about getting up a little of their work, but once we told them we're working with greater MSP than all that the businesses, HR directors there, they opened up more. So we have all of them at the table. We now are getting the businesses together. My board of directors, the Minneapolis Foundation, picks one big issue every year to raise money for. We raise money to help get that kicked off. So now we're rolling. Now we're beginning the campaign of going out and getting young people signed up to be part of it. So what they have to do is to agree to be part of that. We reach them through trusted organizations that they have a relationship with. We then connect with their LinkedIn page. And so whenever they update their LinkedIn page, it automatically links up. So, instantaneously when they do that, an HR director searching for someone can get that to it. So we expect it to be successful, but check in a couple of years. Yeah. Go ahead.
What things did you put in place so that the culture was a welcoming culture as you all established diversity and priorities?
I'm so sorry, I couldn't hear all that.
What things did you put in place so that the culture became a welcoming culture as you established diversity as a part?
Yeah. What was put in place to make this a welcoming culture for diversity? Well, first off, I don't want to be really real with you to say we've got plenty of challenges doing that right now. This is not perfect. But a couple things have been an important part of it. That value that I think has been baked into the DNA of this place since almost the beginning has been one about the common good. So I think that's been a big piece of it. That is meant that we have had a pretty good nonprofit infrastructure. I would say an incredibly good nonprofit infrastructure. So those organizations I mentioned, Advocates for Human Rights, the Center for Victims of Torture, and all of them, every one of those are supported by a really robust civic community. When I went from being mayor to being head of the foundation, in a lot of communities, that would be sort of a nice little retirement job for the guy at the City of the Foundation. In this community, it's a step up because the thing I guess I can say is that politicians have never run this place. It's a civic infrastructure. We have good politicians, we have bad politicians, mostly a lot of really good, solid ones, but the civic infrastructure is where the juice is. And that even translates like, if you really want to move into this town, make a mark. You know, Houston, I imagine you buy a big house. Here, you determine which boards you get on and who is most active in raising money for what organization. I don't mean to put it in a superficial way, but it's the civic world leads this place.
I was struck by your comment about the student who had to go from Minneapolis to St. Paul and travel around town, and was sort of struck on the way over here, highways, metro system, river. Can you talk a little bit about transportation and sort of control?
Right. This is my mom's first husband was from St. Paul, and she lived in Minneapolis. And this was like in the late 50s. And it was a big deal. You have to go to the other street car. It took about an hour to get there. It was a long journey. But the freeway was put in, changed that pretty dramatically. But culturally, I think the psychographic boundaries are there as much. And I mean, obviously, you guys are more separated between the Louisville, the bigger distance. But still, there is this sort of psychographic thing. I never go to Lexington. I never go to Louisville flat, you know. And so I think that's part of it. Now, there's been a huge effort to move forward on regional transportation. And there have been some victories and some losses. You know, I think many of us are frustrated we haven't moved faster. We've built several, two light rail lines, and a couple more in the planning. That's fine. But it's difficult. One of the things is it's really important to figure out how to do the politics of transit. The biggest victory we had actually in different, is that similar in your place? Well, the biggest victory we had across ideological places was actually building bus rapid transit into the 35W freeway. When I came into office, a lot of people in the city were absolutely rock solid. There would never be an expansion whatsoever of anything on that freeway because there was a lot of anger about tearing up neighborhoods. And I understood that. My parents' bus was right up for that freeway. I was not going to be the mayor to grow the proof. Meanwhile, the people in the suburbs were saying, gee, we want to get more transit and all that. And then there was a big political divide about the more progressive city wanting transit in the suburbs, not wanting transit. Some of the far suburban people hated light rail. They thought it was a waste of money. They want to see bus rapid transit, if anything, but not light rail. So we really, you know, I came into this whole dynamic and said, okay, how about we decide for a few minutes, what do we agree on, what do we not agree on? So a group of mayors up and down, not the polluted legislation, but a group of mayors began working up and down the freeway. We started talking a bit about that. We realized that a lot of the, we could, in the city, we could back off light rail because we could buy this bus rapid transit thing. And the bus rapid transit advocates liked it because they wanted to show that it was better than light rail. So we went with that thing. But the biggest issue came up on whether there should be a toll lane. And a toll lane was just, you know, some of the suburban people bought it, the city people hated it. And so there's a super progressive part of Minneapolis. And so they were like, never, ever, ever going to do this. These are Lexus lanes, they said, and they were just hating it. And I said, well, why do you think of them as Lennon lanes? Redistribution of wealth, okay? Oh, that's great. You know, anyway, somehow we got all of these people together, and now we have like rail going, I'm sorry, bus traffic. We'll never get on rail. We have bus rapid transit going down the freeway. And there are ways, I think, that when we stop talking about what you don't agree with, we start trying to figure out what's common ground. If we found it, you know. We're not perfect though, man. I wish we would be moving dramatically faster on transit.
I wanted to ask you about Generation Next. So folks in this room will know about Partners for Youth, and the mayor talked about One Lexington this morning. I wonder if you could talk a little bit. I know the superintendent and the board are doing a lot of good work around closing achievement gaps. I wonder if you could talk a little bit about Generation Next and their work to change outcomes along the cradle to career.
When I was there over the 12 years, we had a lot of efforts to try to close gaps in schools, especially in our racial. And I was deeply frustrated. But a group came up with a strategy that emerged actually out of Cincinnati with their Strive initiative. And it was really about the idea that let's get all the players at a table and let's look at how we can have an impact together that would have power. And so for the first time, we had the right players at the table. Had the university, who's the co-chair, one of the leaders of General Mills, I as mayor, the mayor of St. Paul, superintendents, foundation heads, so we were all together at the table. And after a year, there were two people who were angry. The person was then head of the Minneapolis Foundation, who said it wasn't working, and me, as the mayor. I thought it was going way too slow. So a little while later, when I announced I wasn't running again, they came to me and said, you think it's a damn easy money to run this thing? And I thought, I first said no, and then I thought, wait a minute, what is the biggest issue in this community? And I think in this country. And it's time to get at it. And what is the key driver? And I believe that's education. So I thought, okay, so I went in there, and we basically had the right people around the table, and we just blocked. We laid out real simple things. Every kid ready for kindergarten, master's leading by third grade, math standards by eighth grade, high school graduation, post-secondary. And we began using really rigorous data and moving forward. So for instance, this state has a really good system for measuring quality in early childhood. It's a certification, so we use that, and we looked at where the gap was in that. And I use this strategy, map gap and role. Put everything on the table, map. Understand where the gap is and who's rolling. So we did all that, and long story, but if you use those numbers, the gap in quality for kids of color in early childhood, it's a licensed family child care in this, that, and the other neighborhood, boom. We laid out a plan, got $1 million for 3 years from one of the big foundations and focused on that. In reading, we did a series of things tying in with what's the district doing, what's out of school, tying all those together. But one of the most, and some of them were very sophisticated actions together, but the most interesting was the most straightforward, it was on high school graduation. So we settled around who's doing good work on high school graduation. And we picked up this really good research out of the University of Chicago. So ask yourselves, what is the one reason a kid doesn't graduate from high school? Okay. So there's mobility, there's family issues, there's race, there's all sorts, you know, name them all. But the number one reason that a kid doesn't graduate from high school, can I get a drum roll, please? Okay, that's really lame. The number one reason a kid doesn't graduate from high school, according to this deep research from the University of Chicago, is they don't have enough credits. Okay, it's like your car. There's a lot of reasons it doesn't work, but if it doesn't have gas, it doesn't work. Okay, so it took them, these brilliant people, 2 years to figure that out, and then they asked the question, how do you count credits? Then it starts to get really interesting. Because in Minneapolis and St. Paul schools, and Chicago schools, and most others, there are different ways of counting it, but primarily it means there are a whole lot of juniors and seniors assembling in the counselor's office saying, well, gee, I can't fill out that application because I didn't pass that English class in freshman year, or gym, or art, or something like that. So what they did in Chicago is they set up a sophisticated tracking system so that the second kid didn't pass the English test in freshman year, the classroom, the out-of-school partners, the families, the students were all alerted, and then the whole out-of-school and in-school system aligned around getting that credit recovered. And so, that's what we're setting up. And so now I believe we're going to see graduation rates going up, just like you see in other places. Another place that is really interesting work is what you call opportunity youth, which is a really nice way of saying kids who are falling off the track. We could map out all of these tracks. You know, if they get literally childhood and reading and math and all this is fine, but what happens when they fall off the track? Well, now, one of the most interesting pieces of research is for kids who are really doing poorly in high school, one of the best things you can do is give them post-secondary coursework. Now that's the strangest thing if you think about it. Kids not doing well in high school. So give them college work, or give them work from the vocational programs. Why would you do that? You do it because it works. Because sometimes there are students where the bell doesn't go up. I almost literally flunked out of high school. People say stuff like that, but it was actually true in my case. I was a terrible high school student and a very good college student. It just happens like that sometimes. So a lot of that Gen X work was about that. But then we got into social emotional development, which is the character skills. And then there's super interesting research Dr. Michael Rodriguez of the university did that, the work, and disaggregated for race. So I was so impressed with everything I did, all the testing and math and science, white kids were here and kids of color at different levels below. But when you bring character issues, the whole thing changes. And so when you take the measurement of commitment to learning, which is just like it sounds, who in that classroom is prepared to really learn, white kids are about in the middle. And above them are Hmong, Asian, African-American, Somali. So bluntly, when was the last time you heard some white parents confiding with each other? I need my kid in a classroom with kids committed to learning, finding more African-American, Hmong, Asian, Somali. Okay? But that's actually what the research says, commitment to learning. But when you then go to positive identity, which is, does that young person believe they can learn? All those groups except Somalis crunch. So now paint the picture of the African-American boy. You don't need to spend a lot of time on an average person saying, buckle down for your work. They're more committed on average than their white counterpart. But you do need to say, I believe you can learn. And when you go into the STEM fields, math with problems, science with experiments, you have to walk in there with confidence in your ability to learn. Otherwise, in those fields of STEM, where you fail, failing is part of the learning process, fail the math part of the experiment. If you keep failing, you are reinforcing often your sense you can't do it. So this belief gap matters, but it's different in different groups. So for instance, you take Somali kids and Latino kids, a politician in this community who deals with both of those like me knows that if I walk into this room filled with Latino kids, especially from Mexico, they were probably going to be more reticent. There's more of a distance with authority. Somalis are exactly the opposite. They're all over there asking you to get a visa for their grandma. And it's really out of their culture, right? But translate that into a classroom. And if all the Somali kids are raising their hand and none of the Latino kids are raising their hand, then that doesn't mean that one knows more than the other. There are these cultural differences that we have to take into account. And so this is what some of the really exciting work on that is that we were understanding how to impact some of these things. Sorry to go on about that, but I was just at Gen X board meeting
today, so saying, well, okay, good. I had one. The minor league baseball, we saw the beautiful baseball field. Is it Class A, Double A? Who's the affiliate? And any discussions of where it should be located and how is it funded?
Yes, it's an independent base. It's not a farm team grant, is it? Yeah. But it's a, but how do you get funded? It's a wonderful stadium. It's a really fun experience at St. Paul Saints. So for many years, the Minnesota Twins were looking to do a stadium. And they'd always been in Minneapolis. They stayed in Minneapolis that for a long thing, the county that's Minneapolis and not St. Paul paid for that. And that was right when I first became mayor. Then there became this whole dynamic about what happened with the Vikings. And that was what I didn't love jumping into, but near the end of my term, I jumped into that. In the political dynamic about that football stadium, there was also the agreement, okay, we'll also fund that stadium in St. Paul. And so that, it wasn't quite as literal as that, but it was actually.
And we got a little sneak preview on the soccer. Is that a professional league? Or?
Yeah, that's a professional league. Yeah, and that's going just down the road here in St. Paul. Yeah, and remind me of Bill Murray of our game. Well, thanks very much. I have to love your mayor as a great mayor, but I also look forward to seeing the city. And thanks for coming to see us and come back, especially in the first week of February. You'll love it, I swear.
Thanks again, Mayor. I really appreciate all of your insights. Next, I'd like to invite all